Okay, thank you very much for the introduction, Eunice. And thank you very much, Professor Fourie, because I think you're a hard act to follow, but I'm very glad I am following you, because some of the things that I'm going to say are going to link to themes that you have surfaced. But I want to assure everybody here that I'm going to be awkward today. I'm going to be awkward because I'm not just going to talk about technology, and I'm going to be awkward because I'm going to be relying a lot on a detailed note and scripts, because I'm quoting so many people from a number of other conferences, and I don't want to misquote that. But first, it's good to see some familiar faces here, people I've met at previous events at CPUT, at the Digital Storytelling Festival, at other conferences, but also there, we don't really know each other. So I just want to ask a few questions for show of hands. Firstly, anyone here who teaches with technology as part of their day-to-day teaching? Okay. Anyone who uses Blackboard, ever? Okay. Anybody who uses Blackboard or another learning environment in very deep ways, like you're not just sharing resources, but you're also supporting communication, collaboration, shared activity? Okay, you can see the numbers are a bit less, and that's an interesting gap that we all experience. Anyone who has a smartphone? Anyone who's involved with mobile learning in any way? Well, anyone involved with digital storytelling? Interesting. Okay, anyone here who takes lots of digital photographs? Anyone here who's used film photography any time in the last 5 years? Amazing, okay. So, right, so, the plan is that I'm going to be talking a bit about three conferences, mostly the two previous ones and linking to this conference. And the ways in which those conferences approach things like research methods, supporting student learning, transforming education, teaching with technology, and then look at a couple of wicked challenges, which are actually part of our day-to-day business in South African higher education. Remind me never to download presentation PDF format again, instead to use standard PowerPoint if I'm going to do this. Okay. I got an invitation some months back from Daniela on behalf of the committee to come and do something at this conference. And I'm really grateful for that invitation because it gives me an opportunity to put my attention away from the sabbatical I'm on currently, which, you know, it's much more difficult to do my own research than it is to make a presentation. And also, it forces me to learn, which is a blessing and a curse. That I can't just, I haven't just gone to previous presentations and relayed research, I thought I have to learn something. And it also got me thinking about the fact that we are analog and digital. That we're in this digital world, but we are still analog. And one example of analog, which I've been playing with a bit lately, is film photography. And the people who take film photographs still maybe see that perhaps light talks with the emulsion of the film a bit differently from how it talks to a digital sensor. So maybe what you're doing when you take digital photographs, you do your Instagram, you do other filters, you're trying to actually make it behave a bit more like film sometimes. Okay, with all those peculiarities. And the three conferences. Okay, so we got this. We got the DUT conference, we got the UCT conference, we got the CPUT conference, all of which were supposed to happen in October or November of last year. Well, one of them did. The DUT conference happened in late October. but both the UCT conference and the CPUT conference ended up being time-shifted. And we know why they ended up being time-shifted. Okay, so here's a clip from a student mass meeting at UCT on jamming steps and that area in October of last year, late October. And we know that what happened was fees must fall. Okay, which was the biggest wave of student protest in South Africa, South African universities, since 94. And it focused attention on lots of issues that have been simmering and bubbling for decades, which have received different degrees of attention, but remain unresolved. So in the past, we would talk about a lot, inequalities, diversity, disadvantage, academic literacies, institutional climate, throughput rates, failure rates, and then fees must fall hits the scene with a language which is a bit different, conceptually different, and reframing a lot of the challenges which have been perennial. Words like white privilege, black pain, racism, intersectionality, decolonized education, and the hashtag fees must fall. And I think that there are lots of ways in which many people in this room may disagree or even find deeply problematic some of the strategies and tactics that were used in the movement. And the issues that they are raising are fundamental and can't be brushed under the carpet in the ways in which they sometimes have been in the past. So all three conferences have been affected by fees must fall in one way or another, including the DUT conference, which had a very good panel on trying to make sense of what was happening around the student protests and fees must fall. So again, the key themes of the conferences, which we're going to pick up on. Oh, and I think one thing I will say is that I'm relatively unaccustomed to face-to-face presenting nowadays. Most of the presenting I do nowadays is in cyborg mode, in virtual interactions. So the chance to actually meet people face-to-face like this is quite incredible. Okay. So in terms of the research, the DUC conference had a major theme around what's called legitimation code theory. So it's a framework for studying knowledge and education, being used to analyze lots of practices across social fields. It draws on Bernstein, it draws on social realism, it draws on Bourdieu, really, what they're trying to say is that previous approaches to knowledge either fell into the trap of segmentalism, no integration, or they fell into the trap of knowledge blindness, not actually really taking on issues of knowledge. And we were lucky enough to have presenting to us the founder of legitimation code theory, Carl Maton, from University of Sydney and in Oz. A lot of work going on around LCT, Sue McKenna from Rhodes, supervising students doing research in LCT. Sherry Clarence from Rhodes is also there presenting on her work about applications for LCT. And just one concept that came up. If you look at the semantics of knowledge, Carl Maton introduced us to two variants on this. One, semantic gravity, context dependence, and the other, semantic density, the extent to which one concept is associated with lots of other concepts. And what you're suggesting is that in learning and teaching conversations, often what we're doing is we're moving from a place that is abstracted and decontextualized and idealized to very deep contextualization. So what does this mean in our context right now? And then you move from there to a repacking in order to conceptualize at a higher level. And this is just one of the gems that came out of the presentation. LCT is well worth exploring, and I think it's a very powerful toolkit for educational researchers. Okay, then, the theme of supporting student learning, looking at four aspects here from the two conferences. One of them is a keynote by Ursula Wingate from, I think, from King's College, University of London. Where what she was really talking about here was how you address academic literacies in writing. The problem in many academic literacies approaches is that they either are going, this is about people who can't speak English,
no,
or they're going, this is really about writing, which is totally split off from the way people approach things in the discipline. So her approach basically is to say, the teaching of writing needs to be embedded in the subject curriculum. It needs to focus on relevant genres and on collaboration between writing experts and subject lecturers. And one of the examples that she brought up was the example of genre analysis and how that gets applied. Then the two speakers from DUT who are speaking about mentorship, researched a mentoring program at DUT about the way that program works from the perspective of institutional support, the approaches taken by the mentor, and the way that the mentees were responding to the program and benefiting from the program. Clearly, mentorship is a very important process in education and in terms of development of professional skills as well. Okay, then a speaker from UCT Residence Academic Development Committee talking about collaboration with the Centre for Higher Education Development at UCT in developing undergrad and postgrad programs in the residences. Okay, and these included study skills, writing, essay writing skills, and a program called Conquering the Postgrad Mountain for postgrad students. One of the interesting developments at DUT is a program called Cornerstone, which is intended to support students to take charge of their lives, developed by the International Center for Nonviolence, and eventually it will be compulsory for all DUT first-year students. So, what they've found is that they've developed a very positive classroom experience, and they've cited the example of students preparing and presenting scenarios on issues of HIV/AIDS drawn from their own experience. So very powerful, working in a very sensitive area, and really engaging quite deeply with students' sense of themselves in their lives. There were several events and presentations across the two conferences which focused on how you face transformation challenges head on. So the first one really was a panel on Fees Must Fall. And this panel was a late addition to the program because everybody knew at the time in late October developments around the wave of student protests and government responses were moving really fast. And so the organizers of the conference saw this as an opportunity to try and make sense of what was happening and to try and update us about latest developments in relation to how government was responding to student demands for frees and fees. So the conference included Anthony Collins from DUT, Sue McKenna from Rhodes, and VC Ahun Bawa from DUT. A really interesting and informative panel, picked up on the complexity of the challenges, There was concern, though, about the way in which government arrangements around emergency funding would still leave a shortfall in the university sector, which would leave us then having to deal with various kinds of cost-cutting in 2016. Some vigorous and quite reflective open discussion with the audience, including a number of student activists. At UCT, we had a very interesting and very challenging presentation by a postgrad student called Lindis Richard Young, who drew on the critique by Rose Must Fall, and also her own personal history and her African cultural practices. So, a couple of quotes. The normalization of cultural terrorism has created an emotional and psychological environment that is neither sustainable nor desirable for higher learning and teaching institutions in South Africa and in general. The normalization and promotion of one particular culture as universal while placing as insignificant the African worldview of the universe and life is the core contestation by Rose Must Fall. Another one, the academy has failed to shift their thinking and practice paradigm in favor of sustainable cognitive approaches to understanding human life. And she then went on to make a case for an individual and institutional conscious effort to understand institutional racism and its implications on the functioning and well-being of the university members and the South African society. Okay, so this definitely was one of the more challenging presentations, and I think a very bold intervention by a student at UCT, which I think more than most other higher education institutions in South Africa has this culture of whiteness which needs to be addressed. Okay, so in the humanities at UCT, we had Shannon Moreira and colleagues talking about structural challenges of courses that are compulsory for students from historically disadvantaged backgrounds, and how this may provide some support, and it does provide a lot of support, but also puts students in a place where they may feel they're being targeted or stigmatized. And Galefa Sabidi researched how students on extended curriculum programs perceived two sociology courses and picked up on issues around the Euro or American-centric basis of the courses and the importance of contextualizing to South Africa, including different kinds of local knowledge. At DUT, Anthony Collins focused on how you work with very sensitive topics where there are potentially triggers of deep and painful emotions. And that you can't actually necessarily just say we're going to avoid these issues and play it nice. So what he was really focusing on was how do you manage the risks involved in dealing with sensitive topics to ensure that you're going to be able to maximize the benefits of students engaging with those topics. Can somebody tell me when we're down to 10 minutes? Excellent. Okay. A new genre at UCT was change stories, where educators spoke about how they are involved in educational change and what they're doing for those change processes, but also to some extent about the ways in which they are changing as educators. So for example, Mariam Kajika, who's a psychiatrist and senior lecturer, teaches academic knowledge and relationship life skills. Okay, onto the things that people here really are here for. Ostensibly, teaching with technology. Interesting focus across the different conferences. Some good and useful presentations in both. So a UCT presentation by Isabel Tarling and Dick and Gumby about how teachers use technology, drawing on a teacher training project in partnership with Western Cape Education. I'm looking at a grid where you basically see at the bottom of the grid, there's vertical use of technology. On the right-hand side of the grid, what you actually have is pedagogies which are transformative. And what they were saying was that most of what we're seeing from the teachers was very little use of technology, and often with technologies that with pedagogies that were rather untransformed, and sometimes more transformative student-centered pedagogies. And what you really want to do as a professional developer is create the possibility for educators to use more technology more effectively and to use it in more transformative ways. But their general approach was, okay, we work with the educators, we provide some possibilities, we provide access to the tools. We hope that the educators become more conscious of what it is that they are doing, the position that they have chosen in this grid, and can make conscious choices about where they want to be and what they want to do with it. Looks like quite a useful framework. Okay, I got the opportunity to do a keynote at the DUT conference about online facilitation, and this is one of the slides about the different things that online facilitators do, and there are a lot of things that online facilitators do. At DUT, there was also a presentation, I think by Mark Thomas, about in-service training. Of librarians, an integrated model that includes project-based learning, mentoring, professional identity, marketing, skills, reflective practice, client engagement, the hidden curriculum, and web-based ICTs as a kind of glue and communication system to put together. So, an interesting model there. At UCT, there's been a lot of work going on in relation to MOOCs. There was a presentation about using activity theory to consider how teaching in a MOOC helps you to change your teaching practices. Also a workshop by the MOOC team. And low-tech, analog surfaced again. A project in maths education in the residences to get students learning together, peer learning, collaborative learning, in shared problem solving around physical whiteboards. No smart boards, just old-fashioned physical whiteboards. An idea taken from physics education in UCT, which had used it for a while. Okay, so now. That was really local. So now let's go global. And I know that the leadership around technology at CILT have been reading the Horizon report, and have been reading the Gartner report. And you'll see why in a minute. Okay, some trends, key trends. Driving tech adoption. Cultures of innovation. Rethinking how institutions work. Sound familiar? Redesign learning spaces. Shift to deeper learning approaches. Growing focus on measuring learning. And increased use of blended learning. And I think online learning obviously belongs there as well. Then the upcoming tools. What's on the way in over the next while? Bring your own device. You've got the timing just right. Learning analytics, great. Virtual reality, maybe, will take a little while. Maker spaces, I think for a university which is working with very much of a focus on professional development in technical fields, I think makerspaces are an interesting one to consider. And then, a bit over the horizon, affective computing. Basically, the technology deals with human emotions. And then robotics. Okay, so now let's go to the challenges. Okay, so three sets of challenges. The ones they regard as solvable, the ones they regard as difficult, the ones they regard as wicked. Not in a good sense, necessarily. Okay, solvable. Blending formal and informal. The work is happening. And there's a wealth of experience on that at many of our universities, including CPUT. Improving digital literacy. That work is going on. difficult challenges, competing models of education, it's going to get, there are going to be some crunch points as you force people through opportunities or by circumstance to confront the gap between what the technologies allow and current paradigms. And then personalizing learning, also in part of your plan, then look at challenges, balancing our connected and unconnected lives, and then keeping education relevant. So, the balance between connected and unconnected lives. There are multiple contexts of connection. We're connected at work, we're connected in our studies, we're connected at home. We're connected with people locally, we're connected with people lots of other places. We're also connected when we're offline, it's called human connection. And connection with nature, etc. And of course, we're analog and digital. We are still living in, we are baseline human beings living in physical space. We still need to sleep. We still need to eat food. We still need exercise. We still need contact with other human beings and other life forms. Okay? We will not be digital, even in part, until we start actually getting implants which interact directly with different parts of our brains. Okay, so we consider people in the ways in which we are analog. And this means that we can't treat people as entirely cyborg, digital, etc. And then keeping education relevant. Hang on, we're back to where we started. We're absolutely back to where we started with the challenges raised by Fees Must Fall and many other critics over many years. How do we keep education relevant? How do we keep it relevant to the lives of our students? How do we keep it relevant to the changing world of work? How do we keep it relevant to changes in technology, society, politics, etc.? And this the Horizon Report regards as a wicked challenge. A wicked challenge, which is potentially unsolvable. But actually, this is part of our day-to-day work. This is what we need to do on an ongoing basis for very simple reasons. It's because if we are designing interventions in teaching and learning, we cannot design effective and useful interventions unless we focus on relevance and meaning. So this is at the core of learning design, FLAG learning design workshop later today, if anyone's interested. Okay? So it gets even more wicked, because we're doing this at a time when there is this confluence of urgent requirements to focus on transformation and to focus on efficiency and cost saving in higher education. So, we have the privilege of taking on this challenge, and we do live in interesting times. Yes, I'm about to. And unless we can do this with increasing degrees of success, none of the newest generations of technology will save us from underlying conceptual poverty and deep disconnection, because the relevance of education and engaging with the lives and the future possibilities of students of higher education are fundamental to everything that we do. This is where I stop. Thank you, Daniela. And thanks for your attention and patience.
Thank you very much, Tony, for a thought-provoking presentation. I'm sure there's lots of questions for you. Any questions? Any questions? Yes.
Monique.
Hi.
I want to know, how do you personalize the learning process? Because I also like the idea of going smart and all the digital theater and things like that. But I like the interaction with the students. How do you reach that?
Okay. So the personalization of learning occurs at two levels. One of those levels is that if you are in a smart system, there are ways in which you can actually use that system as a kind of recommender system to recommend resources and possibilities for students based on interests that they've already announced through the interaction with the system. So it's a bit like, in a way, the way that Google actually is responsive, and the websites like Amazon.com are responsive to the interest that you've shown in the system. So that's one way in which you can approach it. Another approach which is deeper in terms of automated personalization is responding to where students clearly exhibit areas of challenge or weakness. So for example, you can say, well, it looks like we haven't quite figured out how to handle this class of problem. Let's suggest a different set of questions which helps you to practice and improve, or let's suggest a slightly different approach to addressing this class of problem. And then of course you have the personalization, which is from your personal face-to-face interaction with students, where the conversation can be much more free-moving. Okay?
Another question, yes, Martin?
Okay, we'll try and do that. Okay, so this is about the framework for the different approaches to teacher pedagogy. Okay, so ask a question as well.
What empirical evidence do you have to say that this is sort of the lower end and this is the higher end of the
Okay, so value judgments. Okay, I'm not making an assumption that quadrant C, which is about transformative pedagogy and lots of use of technology, is necessarily always the best. So it has to depend on context. So if you're in a situation where the students and the teachers have limited access to the technology, either physically or in terms of epistemology, then to try and expect people to do quadrant C is a mistake. So it really needs to be very context dependent. And it really is that you can make a value judgment which is, in general, moving towards more transformative pedagogies is better, although you're not going to leave the students adrift. And so there are times when you're going to have to do straight down the line old-fashioned teaching. And there is an assumption that if you have the technology and the skills available to you, you make use of those when you can. Is that a reasonably sensible answer?
No, I'm saying this because if you, for instance, this day you try to move student from this something from the old to the new, and you find that the student isn't really trying to interact with technology and what is there, you see, you have to take a new system to, for instance, take a time, you find that 100%, I mean, they're not teaching and learning whatsoever, you find that you say, how do you really think that students are able to analyze what is being played through the use of technology?
I think that's a deeper question about digital and academic literacies and about the design of assessment processes which make it difficult for students to just copy and paste. But that's a whole other challenge.
Yeah, but I think also, Tony, that if they want to know deeper into the evidence provided by the authors, I'm sure the paper is online.
It's online in two forms.
Yes, you can download and read.
Yeah.
Any other question? If there is no question, I would like to say thank you so much to Tony.